Hello everyone, welcome back to my channel SkyMap. In 1992, scientists discovered the first two exoplanets orbiting a core of a star, or a pulsar. In 1995, scientists discovered the second exoplanet orbiting a main sequence star. But now the number of discovered exoplanets is more than 5,500. With the help of the Kepler telescope, the transiting exoplanet survey satellite TESS, and most importantly, James Webb Space Telescope, scientists have discovered many exoplanets. So, the news of finding Earth 2.0 or a habitable planet like Earth is very common nowadays. Today, we will find out exactly how much we know about exoplanet, and if any space organization have found Earth 2.0, then how they made it possible. Spoiler alert, if you think scientists have found Earth 2.0, you might get disappointed at the end of the video. Before starting, let's break the topic in three parts. What do we find in an exoplanet to be habitable like Earth? How do we discover the exoplanets? What we have found so far? First, let's talk about what do we find in an exoplanet. The distance between the star and the planet plays the biggest role to be habitable like Earth. If the distance is too high, then the planet will be a frozen ball. If the planet is so close to the star, it will be a fireball, and the planet will be tidally locked to the star. Means the star's insane gravity will force the planet's one side to face the star forever. For example, our moon is tidally locked to the Earth, so we can't see the far side of the moon. In our solar system, Uranus and Neptune are two frozen balls, mainly due to the distance from the Sun. On the other hand, the Sun has almost stopped the rotation of the planet Mercury. It takes a long time to rotate once on its axis due to the proximity to the Sun. So, its one side is burning and another side is very cold. The planet should be at a perfect distance from the star so that the water can stay in liquid form, just like Earth. This perfect distance from the star is called Goldilocks zone or habitable zone. The second most important factor is the host star. Our Sun is a G-type yellow dwarf star. This type of star lives for around 10 billion years. So, this kind of star gives enough time to evolve life in a planet. But the problem is only 10% of stars are of this type. So, finding a G-type yellow dwarf star and a planet revolving around it within its Goldilocks zone is very difficult. Another type of star that can help life to evolve is red dwarf. This kind of star is way smaller than Sun and can live as long as 14 trillion years. But the problem is yellow dwarf stars are very active when we talk about solar wind and radiation. Evolving life can be easily wiped off by the radiation of solar wind. This kind of star carries 8 to 60% mass of our Sun. So, the Goldilocks zone lies much closer to the star. As a result, the orbiting planet will be tidally locked to the star. One side of the planet will face the star forever. Being a red dwarf, our closest neighbor star Proxima Centauri and its planet Proxima Centauri b faces the same problem. The third most essential factor to be habitable planet is the size and mass of the planet. If the mass of the exoplanet becomes higher than Earth, then the G value will also be higher. For example, if the G value becomes twice of Earth, it will create twice the pressure on human body. Walking and running will be way tougher than Earth. Your heart will beat faster to spread blood to every corner of your body. If the planet's mass and size are way smaller than Earth, you will feel the opposite problems. Altogether, the mass and size plays a significant role. The fourth most important factor is the presence of oxygen, water, and biomolecules. These are the building blocks of life on Earth. There are many more factors important for being habitable, like the rotation of the planet, the magnetic field of the planet, the atmosphere of the planet, etc., etc. Altogether, there are many factors to match to call a planet Earth 2.2. If you want to know the truth behind Earth 2.0, you need to understand how we find exoplanets. There are mainly five methods by which we generally find an exoplanet: transit method, direct imaging method, radial velocity method, astrometry method, gravitational microlensing method. Transit method. According to NASA, more than 4,100 exoplanets has been discovered in this method. While orbiting a star, when a planet passes in front of the star, it decreases the brightness of the star. Just for example, see Mercury in front of the Sun. This drop in brightness can be as low as 0.001%, or 1 in 1 million times. Our powerful telescope can detect that. We can detect the number of planets orbiting the star and the distance of each of them from the star by studying the number of dips and duration of dips in the star's brightness in a perfect time interval. In the same way, we can also detect the size, mass, and the orbiting path of the planet. On the other hand, when the exoplanet orbits the star, a small amount of starlight reaches us through the atmosphere of the planet. In another way, when the exoplanet starts covering the starlight, it's the atmosphere of the planet which comes first in front of the star. So, the starlight passes through the planet's atmosphere and reaches us. The composition of the starlight gets changed as it passes through the atmosphere of the planet. Studying this light spectrum, scientists determine which gas and substance are present on that planet and in how much quantity. For example, recently NASA released a spectrograph of an exoplanet atmosphere named K218b, which reveals the presence of methane, carbon dioxide, and the possible detection of molecule called dimethyl sulfide. Scientists also suspect that there might be water oceans underneath the hydrogen-rich atmosphere. Based on the data, they made this artistic illustration of the planet. Direct imaging method. As the name suggests, in this method, we take the image of the exoplanet. The main challenge to take the picture is the distance. Though we can take images of stars light years away, but capturing the picture of a planet orbiting the same star is tends to impossible. To see the planet, scientists block the starlight artificially, because normally the strong light source of a star outshines the dark planet. For this difficulty, the total number of discovered exoplanets in this process is only 69. Radial velocity method and astrometry method. When one or more than one planet orbits, we think it orbits the host star. But originally, they orbit their center of mass. In our solar system, we think we orbit our sun, but that's partially true. We orbit the center of mass of our whole solar system. In our solar system, it's a coincidence that the center of mass lies inside the Sun, as the Sun carries 99.86% mass of the whole solar system. So, we orbit the Sun, in very simple words. Though, the Sun also wobbles a little bit due to the influence of the gas giants. If a star wobbles in the same way or orbits a point, then there must be something around the star orbiting it. We can also calculate the mass and distance of the orbiting planet by studying the star's movement minutely. If the little movement is detected by studying the position of the star, then it is called astrometry method. And if the same movement is detected by studying the Doppler effect of the starlight, then it is called radial velocity method. More than 1070 exoplanets has been discovered in these methods. If you want to know more about these two methods, please write down in the comment section. Gravitational microlensing method. In this method, if the exoplanet carries sufficient mass, then it can bend the light of the host star. When the planet comes in between Earth and the host star, we will either see two stars or a unique pattern of the host star. It will happen in a perfect time interval when the planet will come in front of the star. This method is little tough to understand if you don't know about space-time curve and gravitational lensing method. I'll make a separate video on this topic. Almost 204 exoplanets has been discovered by this method. Let's take a closer look at some discovered exoplanet. According to this article, LP 791-18d is a potentially habitable planet. This exoplanet orbits its host red dwarf star in a very small orbit. The distance is 50 to 51 times smaller than Earth-Sun distance. So the planet can be tidally locked. Moreover, the red dwarf stars are highly active when we talk about solar wind and radiation. This solar system is relatively new, so the volcanic activities are might active on the planet. There is another candidate, very Earth-like, Kepler-452b. This exoplanet is orbiting a star in its Goldilocks zone, and the type of the star is very close to our Sun. But in this case, the planet is 3 to 7 times more massive than Earth, so the G value must be much higher than Earth. The Proxima Centaury b, the nearest exoplanet to Earth, is very Earth-like, with almost the same size and mass. The planet orbits its host star in its Goldilocks zone. But the problem is, the host star is an active red dwarf, and the planet is tidally locked to the star. We also have seen Earth's twin, Venus, with almost the same mass and size. The planet is also in the Goldilocks zone, like Earth. But the absence of rotation, magnetic field, and the presence of carbon dioxide in huge quantity makes it a burning hell, the hottest planet in our solar system. So, altogether, the methods of discovering exoplanet is not sufficient to predict that Earth 2.0 has been discovered. Knowing an exoplanet's orbit, distance, temperature, mass, size, composition of atmosphere, and other basic information can be fascinating for human being, but not enough to rename the planet as Earth 2.0. It may sound odd, but we can't confirm an exoplanet as Earth 2.0 until we visit there. I know, tough to realize, but it's true. I think this video will help you to differentiate between clickbait and the truth. If you found this cosmic journey as fascinating as I did, please give this video a thumbs up and share it with your friends and family members. And remember, keep looking up, stay curious, and explore the mysteries of the night sky.